Shuchi putram atrasupam rupam tasya prajamuri purim maturim gustvati radha kundam girivaram ahurarika Shri Guru Tam Natosmi Gurave Kaura Chandraya Radhikaya Tadaya Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Tad Bhaktaya Namo Ananda Lila Maya Kaya Hema Bhadivyat Chavi Sundraya Tasmai Mahaprema Sapradaya Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Bhaktya Vihina saying, you should go to the holy place, the Tirtha.
Why? The purpose for going to the holy place is that we can meet with sadhus, with pure devotees. And there, if one is fortunate, one may serve them. And what is the result of that service? Shushusrosa tadhanasya vasudeva kata ruchi. To get ruchi, taste, in hearing Harikata. This is the purpose. Dharmasunastita pungsa visvaksena katasuya natpariyam yadiratin srana eva hi keva. Sutta Goswami Pad said, if one doesn't develop a taste for hearing, I want to hear about the beautiful, sweet, powerful pastimes of Sri Krishna in Vrindavan. If this eagerness to hear does not come, then everything one has done was srana eva hi keva. Srana means hard labor for nothing. He certainly, eva, emphatically, kevalam, and exclusively, it was a hard labor for nothing. Srinivatam swagata krishna punya sharana kirtana priyantasto hipatrani vitunoti suritsata. Sutta Goswami continues to say that by hearing about the beautiful pastimes of Sri Krishna, then Krishna is so pleased that he enters through the whole of your ear into your heart. And just like a good friend, if a good friend comes to your house and he sees you're not in and the place is a bit messy, he doesn't sit down waiting for you to come back, he starts tidying up. So in the same way, Krishna comes in your heart and being Suritsatana, our good friend, he starts to clean the heart. By hearing Srimad Bhagavatam every day and serving the pure devotees, then almost most of the anartha's unwanted desires become cleansed away. Don't think that by having class every day discussing anarthas, your anarthas will go. This is not the process. We have to know about the stage anartha nivritti and what the obstacles are. But to remove them, we have to hear about Sri Krishna. The naam, rup, gun and lila, pastimes of Sri Krishna. By this, Krishna himself comes and he cleanses the heart. And when most of the anarthas are gone, then bhakti, bhavati, naishtiki, nishta comes. Steadiness in bhakti. Nishta means chitta aikagrata. Chitta aikagrata. One pointedness of the chitta, of the mind. You are thinking, it's very difficult to concentrate. I cannot concentrate. Listen to Harikatha. It's very interesting, very fascinating. You can become absorbed. And you will see that slowly, slowly, after listening 30 minutes, 40 minutes, you are in another frame of mind completely. The chitta ekagrata, the one pointedness of mind comes by hearing Harikatha. If one will chant the holy name with the chitta ekagrata, one pointedness of mind, without offense, then all the gradually realization of Krishna, Naam, Rupa, Guna, and Lila will manifest from Naam Prabhu himself. So, now we continue from yesterday. Perhaps you remember, we heard how Bhagavan Api, although he's Bhagavan, but he's not bothered to do any of the things that Bhagavan does. He's dearly man. He's a hero. He's a lover. He's sweetheart of Braj Gopis. He's not thinking about saving anyone, giving mercy to anyone, delivering anyone, killing demons. That's not the rasa swarupa of Krishna. Chamrani Devi was saying yesterday, Mahavishnu inside Krishna does the demon play. Krishna is a prema rasa nirjaskrita ashwadana. His business is relishing the bellows of prema. So Bhagavan Api, although he's Bhagavan, he's God, but he's like Cupid, Kamade, the God of love himself. He's absorbed. Manas chakre, he made up his mind, rantum, to enjoy loving pastimes, chakre, and he did it. For whom? For himself. Not for any devotees here in this material world. This is very private lila. Private, internal, confidential, only for those who are in the lila. But paradoxically, anusangik, that means incidentally, though the lila itself is very private, it can bestow the greatest benediction on all others who hear with great sraddha. Sraddhani vatanu sunyantana vana yitya. Bhaktir param bhagavati pratilapyakanam pridogam asya pahino chatirena dhira. Even if there's some ignorance, even if there's some lust, when you hear this kata, bhakti will come in the heart and it will drive out all ignorance and all lust. This is the impossible, inconceivable power of this lila of Sri Krishna. So we heard how Yoga Mayam Upasrita, Sri Krishna, he took shelter of his food. He left from Nandagaon, going through Kunjagali, Keshigali, and then he looked at the beauty of the forehead of the moon rising and remembered the face of Radhika. And all his recollection of the first holy lila when through the gula, the red color on the face of Radhika came into his mind. And then he took his flute from his belt and he was raising his flute to his lips. The moon rose, everything was beautiful. How did the moon rise? Now we come to the third verse. We can chant together. Ndristva kumudvantamakantamandila Banam chatat komala gobiranita jago kalam amakrishavam manoharam. So beautiful. And Drishtva means after seeing. What? Kumudvanta. Kumud means lily. Flower, the night blooming lotus. So, that person who causes the blossoming of the night blooming lotus is called Kumadvanta. So, Drishtva Kumadvanta, Sri Krishna saw the moon which causes the blossoming of the night blooming lotus. And he, what did he see? Akhanda Mandalam. Akhanda Mandalam. Mandal means a circle and it was akhanda, not broken. You see, on different nights, say on the Ashtami, the eighth day of the moon, that then you only see half of the moon. So it's Khanda Mandala, not Akhanda Mandala. But this was Akhanda, completely unbroken moon. This moon was so full. You have never seen a moon as full as this moon. Do you know why? Moon is called Sodasakalatmana. That means one who has 16 phases. But if you count the days, from the first day of the moon, Patipada, Dritya, Tritya, like this, all the way through Astami, Navami, Dasami, and you go up to the Chaturdasi, and then it's Purnima. Only 15 kala, only 15 portions to the moon. And then, after the new moon, the first Patipada, down to the Amavasya, the dark moon night, 15. So, the moon has, we see, it has 15 kala. But it's known as Sodasakalatmana. It has 16 kala. Why? Because Lord Shiva borrowed one kala of the moon to wear in his hair. So that's why you only see 15. But this moon was Akhanda Mandala. It was 16 kala. So this is the most full moon you can imagine. Akhanda Mandala. Ramana Nabham. Rama is the name of Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune. But Devi Krishna Mayi Prakta Radhika Paradevata Sarva Lakshmi Mayi Sarva Nkantin Samoyim Para. Radhika is Sarva Lakshmi Mayi. She's the origin of all the Lakshmi Devis. So here Rama, the goddess of fortune, means Radhika. Why is she the goddess of fortune? She's more fortunate than the goddess of fortune. Because in Vedic culture, a lady's fortune is measured by the degree to which she can control her beloved. Not by force, not by threats, not by nagging. Only by the power of her love. So Radhika is really Radha because she can control Swami Paramahansa Krishna fully by her brain. So her name is Rama. Ramananana Anava. Anana means the face. So here he said, very beautiful, this is called Rupak Alankar. In poetry, there are of course figures of speech. So especially in Sanskrit poetry, there are many, many, many types of artistic expressions, figures of speech. So the Rupak Alankar is a metaphor. So the metaphor here is that the moon, Krishna saw that the moon was like the face of Radhika. So this is a special type of metaphor here called Pratip Alankar. Pratip Alankar means that it's against the grain. Pratip. It's the opposite of the, what it should be. Because the rule in poetry is, if you say, oh, this lady's face is like a lotus flower. So, the first thing is called the upameya, the object of comparison. And the second one is called upama, the subject of the standard of comparison. So the standard is the lotus flower, and this person's face is like a lotus flower. But what is more like a lotus flower, the lotus flower or the face? So the lotus, the upama, that is the standard of comparison, is superior to what is being compared. That is usual. But here, we see that, of course, you can't do it the other way around. If the standard of comparison will be lower than the thing it's compared to, then it will be a fault in poetry. That's called Hina Upama. Hina Upama, that is the standard of comparison is less than the thing it's compared with. So you cannot say, oh, you have a very beautiful complexion like mud. This person, he's as strong as a chicken. This is called Hina Alanka. Hina Upama. You can't say that. The thing you compare with has to be the standard. So, of course, here, Krishna, it is mentioned here that we cannot say Radhika's face is like the moon. Because actually Radhika's face is more beautiful than the moon. So it said, Drishvakumadvantam akandamandalam ramananabham, that the moon was like Radhika's face. So it's perfect. Because the upama is superior to the upameya. But it's still a type of pratip alankar, reverse alankar, because for ordinary human beings, then if you say someone's face is shining like the moon, actually the moon is shining more. But for Radhika, no, the moon is like her face, that means her face is the standard. One may say that how is it possible that these things can be like Krishna or like Radhika? For example, Srila Vishnu Thakur, he said, when the devotee comes in the stage of bhava and he sees the beauty of Krishna, he cries and said, please Krishna, forgive me. I said your face was like the moon, but it's much more beautiful than the moon. So I have made an effect. I said your eyes were like lotus flowers, but actually your eyes are more beautiful than lotus flowers. But is there a fault in saying these things? Because Shastra also gives these examples. Krishna Chandra, Padmalochan. Aha, Padmalochan. Radharani cries, oh Padmalochan, oh lotus eyed Krishna. So there's no fault, because there is some similarity. The thing is this, that Radhika's face is not like the moon in this world. Krishna's eyes are not like the lotus flowers in this world. They're like the lotus flowers in the spiritual world. Like the moon in the spiritual world. Why? Because the whole of Vrindavan is actually the expansion of the beauty of Radha and Krishna. And that's why some comparison can be there. In fact, Vrindavan is manifested in such a way only to remind Radha and Krishna of each other. It will come later in the third line. Badam chata koma lagobi ranjitam, the description of the forest. So, and because the moon has a reddish color, it's like Radhika's face but smeared with kumkum. Because when lover and beloved meet, then they decorate each other with the fragrant kumkum, with the pollen of lotus flowers.
Very colorful and very fragrant.
So then, Navakum Kumaranam. And then Krishna thought, no, Moon, I cannot compare you to the face of Radhika. So I'll just compare you to her toenails. Vanam chata komala gobiranjitam. That means the moon, and komala gobi means the soft rays of the moon. Soft reddish rays of the moon are coming. Ranjitam, and they're infusing their color and softly lighting the forest. So then forest looks very, very beautiful. Now here, banam cha, the word cha is used. Why? Because there are three banam. There are three. There is first Dham Vrindavan, then Sakhi Vrindavan, then Sri Vrindavan. So Dham Vrindavan means the Panchayojan Vrindavan. It's the area of five yojanas, the forest of Vrindavan, which everyone knows, Vrindavan Dham. So that's Dham Vrindavan. Then there's Sakhi Vrindavan. Here she is. That's Brinda Devi. She's a very near and dear Nikunja Sakhi, friend of Radhika in the Nikunjas of Vrindavan. And then the last one is called Sri Vrindavan. So Sri Vrindavan means that the forest of Vrindavan is actually the beauty, the luster, the effulgence of Radhika herself. So Sri is Radhika, Sri Vrindavan. So when Krishna looked, he saw the moon and it was illuminating the forest, and he saw Vrindavan, Banam Cha. He saw Brinda Devi, the goddess had come, and he saw the beauty of Radhika everywhere in Vrindavan, and that was causing the waves of love to rise up in his heart. Just like there's a famous verse in Padma Purana. Yatha Radha Priya Vishnas Tasya Kundam Priyam Tata Sarva Gopishu Sevaika Vishnur Vishnu Atyanta Vallabha. Yeah, Vallabha. Vishnu Atyanta Vallabha. It means that just as Srimati Radhika is dear to Krishna, so in the same way, Radha Kund is just as dear to Krishna as Radhika herself. Sarva Gopishu Sevaika Vishnu Atyanta Vallabha. And Radhika, out of all the gopis, is most dear to him. So Srila Rupa Goswami in Upadashamrita, in the last verse, he says, Krishnatsyotscha pranayavasati prayasi gopi radha kundam chasya munibira vitas tadrigeva vyade yat prashta apyalam asulavam kim puna bhakti bhajam tat pramidam sakritapi sarasnatur aviskaroti. Means, of all the various objects of Sri Krishna's love, nothing and no one can compare to Srimati Radhika. And as Radhika is dear to Krishna, this beautiful place, Radhakund, is as dear to Krishna. That Radhakund is very difficult to attain, even for great eternal associates. Even Uddhav, even Narad and others, the four Kumaras, they cannot attain that place. Tat pramidam sakritapi saras nato aviskaroti. If someone will just take bath, snat, they will just take bath in Radhakund one time, their brain will become fully aroused to the highest point. Mahabhava Prajagopit. Amazing. Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur said, do you know what it means to take bath once in Radhakund? It means to completely, 24 hours a day, remain aloof from the objects of the senses. and absorb your consciousness completely in the service of the lotus feet of Radhika, following Rupa Manjari. That is the snan. It is a snan, sarvatma snapanam param. Taking baths, not sarvatma snapanam, it's a total bathing of your soul in the holy name, with no connection with the external world, following Rupa Manjari in the service of the lotus feet of Radhika. That's what it means to take bath in Radhika. And then one's brain will be fully aroused. So, why does Krishna love Radha Kund so much? Because when he goes there, it's so astonishing. When he hears the warbling of the swans who are swimming on the lake, then that sound to him, it's as if it's the tinkling of Radhika's ankle bells. Aneka mantanada manjunu purana vaskala samaja raja hamsa vamsa nikvanati gaurve. It's the warbling of swans. When Krishna smells the combined fragrance of all the flowers there, it seems to be the fragrance of Radhika's coming. When Sri Krishna feels the touch on his body of the slowly moving breeze, it's like the long sighs of Radhika, when he's holding Radhika and she sighs, it's that the wind is like that, touching. When Krishna sees the lotus flowers, then he sees the hastakamal, the lotus hands of Radhika, or the nabhikamal, the navel of Radhika. So in this, everywhere he's looking, he's having, Krishna's having spurti of Radhika by the power of the beauty of Radhakund. So, in the same way, Vrindavan is also, because Radhakund is the fullest degree, but Vrindavan is also the outer manifestation of the beauty of Radhika. Radhika herself has said, Anya Raditoyama Moraman Vrindavan Manamani Eka Kori Jani. O Krishna, for other people, their mind and their heart are the same. That means just as you can change your mind, people change their heart. One day I love you, one day divorce. But Radhika said, my heart never moves. My heart is one with Vrindavan. So Vrindavan is the beauty. All the bhavas of Radhika are expressed here and there in the landscape of Vrindavan. Is it no wonder that it said, Vrindavanam pracharya param ekam nagacchati. Krishna never takes one step outside of Vrindavan. Why? So, vanam cha tat komala gopiranjitam. Sri Krishna looked and saw, and he was having a spurti of the various aspects of the beauty of Radhika everywhere in the features of Vrindavan. Vanam cha tat komala gopiranjitam. And the komala gobi, the soft rays of the moon, were shining onto the sand on the bank of Jamuna. You know the sand on the bank of Jamuna? Very beautiful. Even today, you just look at all the illusion. Very beautiful. So, in the Prakat Vrindavan, Krishna saw that the soft rays of the moon were touching the particles of sand. And it wasn't like sand. It was like countless billions of diamonds. And there was a glow emanating from those diamonds, the sandy bank of Jamuna. And when Krishna looked at that, it was like the glow of Radhika's face. So, Jago, we're coming to the first. Banam chara komala gobiranjitam, seeing the glow of Radhika's face in the diamond-like sparkling sand illuminated by the Jamuna, by the moon on the bank of Jamuna, then Jago. So Jago is the past perfect conjugation of the verb Ga. So Ga means to sing, and it also means to praise. The word Gita comes from the same dhatu, the same verbal root here as Jago. So Jago Kalam.
Seeing this, seeing the beauty of Radhika's face, then Krishna began to praise Kalam.
Kala means sweet sound.
Kala
means sweet sound. And Kala also means the asput. Asput means not clear, vague, opaque. It's not exactly sure, you cannot be exactly sure what it is. So Kala has two meanings. So why is this word, why Shukadeva Goswami saying Kala? Krishna began to praise the sweet sound of his flute, which was both sweet and also indistinct. And Bama Drisham Manoharam. Bama means beautiful, and Drisham means who glances. So those who have a beautiful glance. So Bama Drisha means the gopis who have very beautiful glances. And Manoharam, Mana means mind, Hara means still. Manoharam means enchanting. Enchanting. So that is the potency of sweetness. Sweetness enchants you. It does Manohara. And Manohara actually means it makes you, does Vivek Vinash, destruction of your discrimination. You can't even think, it's just, that's so sweet, you can't even think anymore. So, here, now the confidential meaning, Jago Kalam Bamadrisham Manoharam. Krishna took his bhakti from his waist belt and he began to talk to his flute. Jago, he was praising his flute. Jago. We mentioned before that in the Dut Kavya, when you have a messenger, a poetry about sending a messenger like Hamsa Dut or Uddhav Sandesh, the first part of that poem is always praising the messenger, glorifying him, and then giving some mission and worshipping the messenger also, that his mission will be successful. So Krishna is going to do all of these, because this is now like a dut kavya, and the dut is bhamsi dut. Not hansa dut, bhamsi dut. Krishna said, "Oh bhamsi, I always hold you in my hand. I place you to my lips. You are very, very dear to me. Bhamsi Priyasaki. You are very dear to me. And I always serve you. I am always serving you, but today I require your help, my dear friend. I want you to make such a sound that the gopis, that means the young married girls or brides now, in the night time, will leave everything and come here. Oh my dear Bhamsi, please, Bama Drisham Manoharam," Krishna is saying to his flute. Jago, glorifying the sweet sound of his flute, Bama Drisham Manoharam, oh flute, please, steal the hearts of the Bratimopis. So, just as in a Dut Kavya, in a poetry about the messenger he's spoken to, he's praised, and then he served and worshipped. So then Krishna began to serve and worship his flute. Just like sometimes if you have a deity, then you give an abhishek with the Panchamrita. Right? If you have a Shalakam Shila, then perhaps every day you're doing bathing in Panchamrita, the five types of nectar. And sometimes if you're serving someone, then you give them massage. So then Krishna, he began to massage his flute. Give massage. And then he gave a bath in Amrita, Adaramrita, the nectar of his lips. So in this way, the dude, the messenger, he's been praised, he's been given a mission, and he's been worshipped.
And so now he has to set off on the mission.
Now, when Krishna jago also means the praising but also singing, and it refers to that Krishna caused his flute to sing. And what did the flute sing? That is also hidden here. Kalam Bhamatrisham Manoharam. First, Ka is the letter K. Lam is the letter L. Bhamatrisham. Bhama means beautiful, but Bhama also means left. So we have right, Dakshin, and Bhama. Like you have left wing gopis, Bhama above, and Dakshin above, and right wing gopis. So Bhama means left. So in Sanskrit, when you're writing the letter I, there's a short I, and it has like a hook on the top of the matra, and it goes to the right, short I. But the long I, has a hook on the top that goes to the left. So the long I in Sanskrit is called Bhamadrisha, the letter that looks left. So Ka, La, I. Then Manoharam. Taking the mind, who is the devata, the demigod, who presides over the mental functions of the human being? Chandra. That's why if you go crazy, you're called a lunatic. Because the luna, the effect of the moon. So, the moon is the predominating deity of the mind. So he is Manohara. And in Sanskrit, if you want to, at the end of a word, make a nasalized sound, like Om, you have to make a nasal sound. Then it's written like a chandra, a bindu, a dot. You know, you see if you write Om, and then there's a dot there on the right side. So that's the chandra. So, ka la inga. So hidden in this verse of Shukadeva Goswami is kling. That is the calm beach. Calm beach is the seed of the mantra for worshipping the god of love, Cupid. So, in previous times, if someone wanted someone else to fall in love with them, then they used to worship Cupid and chant this speech. But when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu met Ramananda Rai, Ramananda Rai said to him, Vrindavane aprakrita navinamada Kama bija kama gayatri jara upasan. He said, oh, Mahaprabhu, in transcendental Vrindavan, the ever fresh Cupid is Krishna himself, and his worship should be performed with the beach for the god of love and the gayatri for Cupid also. So, this beach is actually the sound of Sri Krishna's flute by which Sri Krishna calls all the gopis, he stimulates their brain and it overflows, they become out of control, they forget everything, they forget even their own name. They don't know who they are or where they're going. And they just come running to Krishna. And this is why Gurudev, in the second initiation, at the time of Diksha, gives the calm beach and calm Gayatri to the disciple. He's giving the sound of Krishna's flute in the heart of the disciple. And when the disciple will hear this, he will become mad and go be praying and leave everything and run to Vrindavan. So, jago kala bhama drisham manoharam. Now, in Venu Geet, it is said, iti Venu ravam rajam sarva bhuta manoharam. When Krishna was playing the bamboo flute, it attracted everyone. The trees, the cows, the peacocks, the Jamuna, the birds, and each verse of the Venu Geet is describing it, the effect of the Venu on different creatures. But now Krishna is playing his golden bansi and akarshini. So akarshini, we explained yesterday, is very choosy. It's a targeted, tactical weapon, if you like. So, here is the explanation of the word kalam. That the sound was sweet, but it was kalam indistinct. The first meaning is that the bridge basses heard the flute, but they heard, you know, someone is playing flute somewhere. Now usually, if Krishna played his flute, they were, oh, Krishna's playing a flute. But because this is Jagaukalam, by the mystical power of the Akarshini, it's an indistinct sound that all the people in Braj at night, they hear, well, someone's playing somewhere in the forest, but they don't know it's Krishna. So Kalam, indistinct. Asputam. Yeah, Kalam means Asputam. And the second meaning is that the beautiful gopis heard, Krishna is calling me. Krishna is on the bank of Jamuna and he's calling me. Come, come at once. Esho, esho. And the third, so that's the second meaning of Kalam, that it's indistinct. It sounds like this to one person, but like this to the gopis. And the third meaning of Kalam, indistinct, that the same sound of the flute, actually the flute was singing, Hey Radhe, oh Kamalaruchi, oh you are as beautiful like a lotus flower, oh Vrindavanishri, hey Kante, oh my beloved, oh Mat Praneshri, oh the queen of my prance, Agatscha, Agatscha. If you are Brahmin and you know how to do fire, you have to bring the deity into the appear in the fire at the beginning, and you have to pray. Vaishnavagne, Agatscha. So the flute is Agatscha, Agatscha. So even though the flute was saying, oh Radhe, Praneshri, Vrindavaneshri, come, come, Kala, Kalam, it was indistinct. The gopis only heard Krishna is calling me. But Radhika heard directly that the flute, Krishna is begging her to come. Please, I have a very strong desire to meet with you. Please come and please me. So Radhika cannot live. If Radhika feels that Krishna is undergoing any inconvenience, she cannot live. So the actual deep meaning of the flute, it was only clear to Radhika. Now, you have to know Krishna is called Chaura Graganya Purushottam. Chaura Graganya Purushottam, that means he is the gang leader. He's a leader of a group of thieves. So the chief gangster, the godfather, he actually doesn't do any crimes himself, right? He doesn't go out stealing or killing anyone or do anything. He stays in his office and he sends his messengers out and they do everything. So Krishna's Chaura Graganya Purush, he's the leader, gang leader of a group of thieves. So he's sending his Shishya Shiromani, the crest jewel of all of his disciples, to do this thievery. So, Krishna is there playing, and from the flute comes Venu Nad. Venu Nad means the sound of Krishna's flute. Venu Nad. Madhurima rasa bapi Matahansi Pajalpa Pranayakum Kushumabaki Bringa Sangita Gosha Surata Surata Samara Peri Pankriti Putanare Jayatiridaya Tansi Kopi Bansi Ninada. This verse is this glorifying Bansi Nad. Bansi, the sound of the flute. What is the glory of this flute who has set out? Madhurinam vasavapi matahansi prajalpa. You can imagine, there are the Rajahansa swans, and they fly for thousands and thousands and thousands of miles. And finally they come high in the Himalayas and they arrive at the Manas Sarovar. And finally they can land. And that is the place where they go to mate, actually. So they're very happy to arrive there at their destination. But here, Srila Kavikarnapur is saying that they have not arrived
onto a lake of water. But you can imagine what is the sound of the singing of swans who have become intoxicated by landing on a lake of madhur rasa. How sweet their singing will be. Pranayama kusubhaki, bringa sangeeta gosha. When a bumblebee sees a garden full of flowers, it becomes very excited. Becomes really hyped up. Right? And they go and they land on the flowers and the bumblebees are just really, really, how can we say, on high speed. They're so excited. Kavikana Puri saying, this sound of Krishna's flute is so sweet. It's like the singing of a bumblebee who's landed in a garden of flowers made of love. Not made of the just carbon and other chemicals, but just made of love. So joyful. And Surita Samarabheri Pankriti. Just as before battle, then the armies, they have drums, kettle drums. And it announces, now the battle will begin. So in the same way, Surata Samarabheri Pankriti Bhutanare. Krishna, who when he was only 6 days old, Kilputanare, is very strong. So the sound of his flute is like the beating of kettle drums to announce now there will be the love battle. Surata Samarabheri. And this sound, this Bhamsinar is coming. Now, this thief is very clever. You see? If you want to steal from a house, don't go to the front door. You have to go around the side entrance. So this thief didn't go to the front door, he went to the side entrance, that means the ears of the gopis. Entering into the house of gopis through the side entrance, then he came to the treasury room. And there was the treasury box. The treasure chest. That means gopis chitta. The hearts of gopis. And inside that treasury chest, you know what are the jewels in the chitta of a young woman? Lajja, shyness. Vivek, discrimination. Dharya, patience. All the good qualities of a young woman, they're the treasures living in that treasury box of the chitta. And when the thief stole them, he just grabbed them and ran with all the treasures. Quickly, back through the forest and brought them all to Krishna. And now Krishna has it in his hand. All the treasures of the patience, the shyness, and the discrimination of every gopi in Braja. You know, if someone is walking in the crowd on the street and someone bumps into them and it's a pickpocket and just took something out of the pocket and the person notices, hey, you just took my wallet, then what does he do? He runs after that person to catch him. Stop, thief! So exactly in that way. Braj gopis, they just from wherever they are, they got up and they began to run, chasing after that thief. And they ran into the forest of Vrindavan and they saw Krishna standing there like this, holding all their hearts and all the treasures of the heart in his hands, and they've come there to beg for him. Oh Krishna, this heart, this patience, this discrimination, this shyness, it's mine, belongs to me, you have to give it back. So they want to come to pray to Krishna because they cannot live. Without chitta, you cannot do anything. So, jago kalambama drisham manohara. We're just explaining manohara, what it means, stealing the heart. So, verse 3, now we're going. The Venu man has come, stolen the heart, and then what did gopis do? We're coming to verse. We can sing.
Himi sham yagitam taranaka vadanam rajasriya krishna grihita manasa ahajak muranamanyam alokshita tima sariyat prakantum.
example of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, try to be always singing in the nectar of Srimad Bhagavatam. Every syllable is like endless ocean of nectar. Nishamya Gita. Nishamya means hearing. Gita, the song. So it's called Gita. What does song mean? There's two types of poetry, kavya. Kavya means poetry, but one special type of poetry is called Gita Kavya. So Gita Kavya has five qualities. One, bhavutta. Gita Kavya awakens strong emotions. Bhavutta. Two, in Gita Kavya, there is the Atma Vivakti. Atma Vivakti means expression of one's own personality. In ordinary Kavya, someone writes a poem about someone or something, but not themselves. But the speciality of Gita Kavya is it's one's own heart expression. So this Venu Geet, Krishna is expressing his deepest desire, his heart. And it's doing Bhavuta, awakening deep emotions in Braja Gopis. Then, third, is that Gita Kavya is succinct. Like, the shortest chapter of the Rasa Panta Jaya is another 31, Gopi Geet. It's a Geet. So it's very short, only 19 verses. Whereas other types of Kavya may be an epic. Thousands and thousands of verses. So Gita should be succinct and to the point. Then, the fourth quality is it should be kalatmaka, full of art. That means layers upon layers of different alankars, different figures of speech and rhythms. If you look at Gopi Geet, the arrangement. Jayati teyadikam janmana braja straitarindira shashwadatrahi daitadrishyatam dikshutavakas twaititashavash tambichimvate. In every single line, the first syllable, jayati teyadikam janmana braja, and then the seventh syllable is repeated. Srayat indra shashodatrahi chash. Dayat drishtam. Dikshutavaka dadda. Dvai drishasavas tangachinvate. Like this. So the artistry, a geet should be extremely artistic. So that is called kalatmaka. And then the fifth one is it should have a melody. It's a sangeet. It should be sung. So these are the things that make Gita different from ordinary Kavya. So Nishanga Gita, the gopis heard this sound which was a very artistic expression of Krishna's heart. His feelings of separation from them and his pronouncement of his love for them. Ni, the word ni here, the prefix ni is ishat. Ishat is just a little bit. Little. So they heard Nishamya, they heard a little bit. That doesn't mean they didn't hear the whole thing, but it means that only hearing a little bit of this song was totally effective. Sometimes when you take a medicine, maybe you have to take 6 pills. But if a medicine is very strong, like a homeopathic medicine, then the medicine is put in water, and then it's the one particle is given, and then that's diluted 100 times, and then one particle is given, that's diluted 100, and a very small amount has the effect. So Krishna's flute is so powerful that not even hearing the whole song to the end, only Nishamya Gita, a little hearing, and the full effect, Manoharam, their hearts were stolen. Nishamya Gita tad ananga vardhanam. What was that full effect? Ananda Vardhana. One meaning is that the Ananga, that is the love for Krishna in their hearts, Vardhana increased or amplified the message of the song.
If someone sings a song, which you have no sentimental connection with the song, then it doesn't affect you. But if someone has a very romantic memory connected with that song, then that person. So Ananga, the love in the heart of the gopis, caused the power of the song to be amplified. So Ananga Vardhanam. So that Ananga Vardhanam is in a samas, that is a compound, with the, that is a tritiya, sorry, chaturthi, that is the, called the fourth case, chaturthi, the instrumental case, anangena vardhanam. And then in the sixth case, anangasya vardhanam, means the sound of the flute increased the ananga. Now ananga means God of love, but not the love of a servant, not the love of a friend, not the love of a parent, the romantic love, ananga. Why? Because when praying is a spurna, that means slightly manifest in the heart, then it's called praying. Like sambandhatmik praying. But when praying is, love is so powerful that it takes over the whole body, and that love is manifested in every limb and expressed in every limb of the body, then it's called kama. Kama praying. Now Srila Rupa Goswami Pada describes that the love of brides can be divided into two parts, the love of the servants and the friends and the parents. That's called sambandha rupa or sambandhatmik. But then there's kamatmik. So don't think that the gopis' love is selfish or lusty or anything like that. It's love in the heart which is so intense that it takes over the entire body, and every limb of the body is expressing that love. So it's called kamarupa bhakti. So ananga vardhanam, the hearing the sound of the flute, the praying in the gopis' heart manifested on every limb of their bodies, and they became very eager to run to Krishna and serve him as his beloved. Nishanga Gitam Tarananga Vardhanam Brajastriyaha. Brajastriya. Stri means, Striyaha means the ladies in the plural. Braja. The word Braj means a Braj. But Braj has three meanings here. First meaning of Braj is always moving. Gopis are always moving, going from the house to the forest, from the forest to the house, from the house, from Yavat to Nandagam, from Yandagam back to Yavat, from Yavat to Suryakund, from Suryakund to Radhakund, like this. So, because they're always moving, so they're Brajastriya. And Braja also means a group. So they're always moving in groups. Radhika's going with the whole phalanx. They can do chakravyuhan. So they're moving. Radhika is there, Lalita one side, Vishaka one side, Ratimanjari going in front to check the path, Rupamanjari behind. Others are like this, so Radhika's moving. All the Rajagopis, they're moving in groups. And then the third meaning is they are Striya. Beautiful young ladies of Vrindavan, Brajastriya, who have within their hearts groups of emotions. Many Sanchivas, many different emotions at the same time. When they saw that their hearts had been stolen by Krishna's Shishya Shiramani, Krishna jewel of all of his disciples, the Venu Nad, then they rushed to Krishna. Krishna Grihita Manasa. Krishna Grihita Manasa means that their manasa, their hearts, had been grihita, caught in the fist of Krishna. Nishanga Gitam Tadananga Vadanam Vrajastriya Krishna Grihita Manasa. It's a powerful poetry. Ajagmuhu means they came. Now Shukadeva Goswami is not saying that they went, he's saying they came. Why? Because the Parata Radharani already flowing, he's already there. So he's already there where Krishna's waiting, and he's watching the gopis arrive there. So he's not saying the gopis went to Krishna. He's in his trance, he's there, he's seeing it. He said, oh, then the gopis came. Ajagmuhu. Ajagmu Anyonyam. Anya, Anya makes Anyonyamya. Anyonya. Anya plus Anya, Anyonya. So that means Anya is other. Alakshita means unseen. In other words, they ran there not seeing each other. So this is some irony, because it says Brajastriya, that means these girls who always go everywhere in groups, their heart was stolen by Krishna, but they didn't go in groups. Anyanyam alakshitodhyamaha. That means that the gopis are always aware of each other, caring for each other. If they want to go somewhere, are you ready yet? Oh, I'll be ready. Okay, I'll wait for you. So they're always like that. But the intense urgency of this moment, the way that they become overwhelmed with the Mahabharata, they forgot everything. And that's why, though it's their nature to always move in groups, and Yonyam Alokshitutyama, they just ran and they didn't even see each other. Of course, until they arrived and saw, there's so many gopis had come. Sayatra kanto javalola kundalaha. Sayatra, they came there, and their kanta, where their beloved was waiting, and as they were going, javalola kundalaha. That means their earrings were trembling. When you run, it's natural that if you have long dangling ornaments, they're going to be trembling. But we should know that everything in Braj is bhavmay. Everything is made of bhav, ecstatic loving emotions. So if the earrings are trembling, it's not because of whatever, centrifugal force or something. Right? It's not because of physics or anything like that. So what is the meaning? Because the earrings were afraid. The jeweled earrings were thinking, if this Krishna is such a thief, that he can steal the jewels which are hidden in the heart, then we are in a very precarious position, us jewels who are hanging on the outside. So, javalola kundalaha. And also, they were trembling. Why? Because when Radha and Krishna meet in the Nikunjas, and they embracing the Nikunjas, and their love battle is going on, then what happens? All the ornaments get broken. The necklaces are broken, the pearls go here, the jewels go there, the earrings go here and there. So because Krishna was inviting them, Surata Samhara Devi Bankriti Putanare, his flute song was the beating of the drum to announce the coming love battle. So all the ornaments of gopis were trembling, thinking that they were going to get smashed. So, javalola kundala. Oh, I'm already over time. 10 minutes over time. How did Braj gopis leave their homes? Tuham cho biyayu kaschit doham hitpa sumatsukha payo distrit jasam yavavam anudvasya paraya yuhu. There are two types of duties, messengers. The first one just delivers the letter. Let's say you want to deliver a message to someone, you write it down, you give it to the person, and they go and they give the letter and then they come back. So that's just called Sandesh Karini. Sandesh Karini. The messenger who just gives the letter and comes back. But then the next one is called Nisrista Artha Buddhi Duti. Nisrista Artha Buddhi. That means the intelligence of this messenger is such that they will not finish their duty, they will not give up their mission until the purpose of the mission has become completely fulfilled. That's totally different. Any person you can ask to be a postman and deliver a letter. But if the letter has a particular request that's to be fulfilled, then a messenger is very intelligent and very powerful, should be sent to make sure that the request in the letter is fulfilled. So Bansi is the best duty. The flute of Krishna does his duty in such a way, he won't stop singing until there's a complete success and all the desires of Krishna are being fulfilled. So at the time when the sound of the Venunad came into the village of Braj, different gopis were doing different things. So there's a saying that if a work is very important, you can leave 10 other types of work for that one type of work. So here Shukadeva Goswami is going to describe 10 types of work that Braja gopis were performing. And they're going to leave them all for one type of work, that is pleasing Krishna. Each one of these types of work represents something which is important to us in our life. Like our jat karma, what is the duty of our caste or social position, our deha, our attachment to our body, our attachment to our friends and family members, all different types. So here, Shukadeva Goswami is giving 10 examples of 10 gopis and 10 things that it's possible to be attached to in this world, and how the Nisrit art of buddhi duty of bhakti just takes gopis away from all of these. They leave everything behind. And even the devotees hearing this sweet katha, jago kalam bana drishoharam, they should also be nivritta, completely detached. This katha is not to enjoy. By hearing this rasalila, one sees that the whole world is like straw, has no value, and my true life is there in Vrindavan. So the 10 works that the Nisrit Artha Buddhi duty of Krishna's flute has separated the gopis from, we'll explain in the festival next year. Jai Jai Sri Ram.